schools or even diploma programs that we are starting with. So let me then go to the main topic of this talk, which is transcription. So this is, in this scheme, I show what is called the central dogma of biology, in which, well, this is what the process that is called gene transcription, in which DNA is transformed into proteins, which make the building blocks of the cells and organisms. So here is the first process that occurs in the cell nucleus in eukaryotes, which is called replication of DNA. So DNA can be replicated by DNA polymerases. But next, DNA is transcribed into RNA, which is this molecule here, by macromolecular enzymes called RNA polymerases, which is the ones that I will discuss about today. So I will talk about this process. Next, there is translation that is done by ribosomes, but I will focus today in this process that happens in the nucleus of the transcription of DNA into RNA. So this is an active process, and it occurs, like I show in this illustration. So this is the RNA polymerase. I will play it back, which moves along the DNA template stepwise, producing a complementary RNA transcript. So this is a process that that requires energy. This doesn't happen by chance. And this is fueled by hydrolysis of ATP. So this is, let's say, in an aqueous medium in which there are these A, U, C, and G, which are nucleotides. This means this is, for example, ATP that binds in every step, in a single step, to the active site of the RNA polymerase, which is located here. Then it gets stuck here in this site, and then hydrolysis happens. So one phosphate group is released, and as a result, this is a very nice chemical reaction that gives 10 kBTs of energy, and therefore it allows the RNA polymerase to move forward. It is important that this is 10 kBTs, because if it would be only 1 kBT, this means that one molecule of water could come here and move this polymerase backwards. So it must be something that gives more energy than the thermal energy in order to advance along the DNA chain. So please, if you have any questions, just don't hesitate to ask. I will try to do my best. So this is a scheme of transcription elongation. But as I say, this process is not perfect. So sometimes the RNA polymerase makes a mistake, or it finds an obstacle in its way. When this happens, the phenomenon called backtracking happens, in which the RNA polymerase, you see, the active site now is blocked, and it cannot incorporate new nucleotides. This is like moving backwards in the direction of polymerization, and it's not beneficial for polymerization, but it could be beneficial, for example, to correct mistakes in the RNA code. And this is the very important process in biology. That is what I will discuss today in my talk. So once the RNA polymerase is backtracked, so you see here the active site is blocked, what the polymerase wants to do is to keep the active site free. So you can free the active site in via two mechanisms. One is diffusion. So you can diffuse all around the polymerase, left and right, in such a way that the active site moves this way, this way, this way, until you find the 3' end of the RNA, which is this thing. So this would be one way for polymerases to recover from a backtrack or from a pause, from a transcriptional pause. Another way that has been found experimentally, and I will discuss more in detail later, is that polymerases can also cleave. So they have some sort of scissors that can cut all this backtrack RNA and resume elongation in an efficient way. So these are two mechanisms. At least it's known that there are two mechanisms that polymerase use to recover. But what is was not so clear is how and when do RNA polymerases choose between either diffuse or cleave to recover from a backtrack. This is the objective of the work that I'm presenting today. And we combined experiments and theory to answer this question. So, in experimental context, I will discuss which is the main tool that is used for these experiments. The tool is called optical tweezers, which was developed mainly by Arthur Askin already in the 1970s. and which gave him, this year, at his age of 91, the Physics Nobel Prize. So what is an optical tweezer? Basically, in few words, an optical tweezer is a highly focused laser that is able to trap matter with light. So here you see a laser beam going upwards, and there is a intensity gradient, so the laser beam is more intense here than here, and it's able, due to this intensity gradient, to trap particles in three dimensions. So I was working for some years in an optical tweezer lab, in the lab of Dmitry Petrov, and he showed all of us, well, many things in life and in physics, but he liked to discuss trapping of particles with something that is traditional in Catalonia, which is called low combat, which is what I'm going to show now in this movie. So, okay, the volume is a bit high, so I have to take it out. But you see here this egg that is being pushed by a fountain of water, and it's held in air thanks to the balance between two forces. One is the gravitational force that is pulling the egg down, and the second is the pressure done by the water that is a force that pushes the egg upwards. So the balance of these two forces produces that the egg can float in the air. So here is similar. There's a laser beam that exerts pressure on the particle, and there is a second force. It's a bit more complicated to explain. It's called the gradient force, that is due to the fact that there is a gradient of intensity in this region. So the compensation of these two forces makes the possibility of trapping objects like colloidal particles, bacteria, virus, etc., in three dimensions. So let's say here is holding matter with water, and here is holding matter with light, but light has momentum, and therefore the momentum can be used to push particles or pull. So let's say this is a very important experimental setup, and it's very precise. So the force sensitivity is of the order of piconewtons, 10 to the minus 12 newtons, and the spatial sensitivity is of nanometers, 10 to the minus 9 meters. Why this is precise? Well, I will tell you briefly. So here is a bead, so let's say a colloidal particle of the size of a micron, and it's surrounded by water molecules. And you would like to see, for example, at room temperature, a fluctuation. So when a water molecule hits the bead and moves due to thermal fluctuations. So what is the characteristic energy of a thermal fluctuation? It is KBT. This is Boltzmann constant, and this is the temperature, which I put here, 30 degrees. When you put KBT in joules, well, it's a very small number, but if you put it in piconewton nanometer, it is 4. So KBT is of the order of piconewton nanometer. And with this optical tweezer, you can measure piconewtons and nanometers. So you are able to resolve fluctuations. And this is why they are very important for this process. So a key discovery using optical tweezers is the direct observation of base pair stepping in RNA polymers. So this, in this experiment, what they do is they have two optical tweezers, which are these pink drawings, and they use this optical tweezers to trap two colloidal particles. And then one of the colloidal particles is attached to a polymerase, and the other is covered by DNA. Then the two beads are put together, and one pulls one of the two traps apart. And if you are very, very, very lucky, you get a DNA chain connecting the two beads and an RNA polymerase that is producing from DNA RNA. What happens when this is moving is pulling this particle, and when you pull the particle, the force exerted on this particle is different than when the particle is here. So with this device, you can measure forces directly, and with the force, you can infer the distance or the end-to-end distance in this DNA chain. In this way, you measure where is the RNA polymerase moving, if it's moving stepwise or not. This was a key discovery because it was possible to measure, so this is the resolution, 3.4 angstroms, and they could measure jumps of the size of 3.4 angstroms. 3.4 angstroms is just the base pair distance, the distance between two nucleotides. But it was a very important discovery that allowed to measure transcription with a single molecule and one at a time. So you can see stepwise moving the RNA polymerase. This was a very important discovery, which is the basis of our work as well. So I will show you now a movie to tell you this is not 1D, it's a more complicated story. This movie was done by Mario Avellaneda, a colleague of mine. I met him in Dresden. He's now in Amolf and works in this company. And look, here is an example of a typical experiment that you can do. Here are two optical tweezers, and they are covered by different proteins. Here is a very long protein, this is a short one, a receptor. And in this work, they tried to measure binding events between this protein and this protein. And you see that when you get closer and closer to the optical traps, if you're lucky, as I say, you can catch one protein with the other and measure the force signal in one of the traps. So you will see when a binding event occurs, this bead is moved, and therefore the force measured in this trap has this type of behavior. So it's pulling, 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 and then it's released when the two proteins unbind. And then you can repeat this many times, but of course, it's much easier to see this in an animation, in a movie, than in an experiment. Experiment, there are many challenges that I'm not discussing now, but mainly this movie is to show you that this is an excellent tool to study phenomena at the mesoscopic scales.
So what we are trying to do from that plot that you have for force as a function of time, we want to estimate the bond energy.
Yeah, well, with this type of experiments, you can do a lot of things. So mainly in the RNA polymerase, what you do is, well, let me go to the next slide because it's a bit better. What you do is you measure the force in one of these the force exerted by the trap in one of these beads, and then what you want to know, especially in RNA polymerase, is where is the RNA polymerase. So you would like to resolve the position of the RNA polymerase along the DNA template. By this I mean that when you advance here, so when you continue polymerizing, you see that you go from this state to this state, so the chain has get longer, and the DNA has been introduced here in the RNA polymerase. So the end-to-end distance between the two traps, or between the two beads, sorry, has been reduced. So what you would like to know is what is this distance at the time t. Okay? You follow me? So, of course, you cannot see the distance very precisely, but you can measure very precisely, well, it depends on the experimental setup, but sometimes, for example, in the Bustamante lab, they measure the force in this trap. So from the force, it is well known that more or less the force exerted by the trap on the bead is like a spring, so it's minus kappa x. So they can know where is this bead. They can know then from this force where is this bead, and then using some models for the polymers, they can get also the end-to-end distance in the polymer. So the key point would be to measure where is the polymerase at the time t. Okay, where in the DNA template is the polymerase? Was it clear?
Yeah.
Okay, actually, out of these experiments, you can get this type of traces, where this is the position of the RNA polymerase along the DNA template versus time. So you see when RNA is being polymerized, you have this type of traces. So there is like, you see there are fluctuations due to, this is in an environment, in a thermal environment, so these beads fluctuate. This is also fluctuating, but there is a net drift in one direction, which is due to polymerization. So here you see these traces, that when it's in the black state, it means it's a polymerizing RNA, but sometimes there are pauses, like these red colors here. And this is when the polymerase is doing the backtracking. So this bead is not moving, because this is not moving anymore. So this is what we are highlighting here. So in this experiment, in the 2007, in the Bustamante lab, they measure not only how many pauses occur, but also the time. So how long the polymerase is paused. For example, here it takes, I don't know, 3 seconds, here it is 1 second, and so on. And they built a histogram of the dwell time distribution, so of this duration of pulses, which is shown here. These circles are experimental results, and this red line is a theory. The theory is very simple. So basically, they realized that there is a power law in the distribution, t to the minus 3 halves, and they proposed a random walk model to describe this data. And a random walk in one dimension, because you have the polymerase is more or less running one dimension. You have the DNA template, and you advance one forward, one backwards in a line. So they represent the dynamics of the polymerase during the backtracking as a diffusion in an periodic energy landscape as this one, where here this ball is representing the position of the RNA polymerase. And what they say is that during the backtrack, so not during here, because here is another story, but during the backtrack, this is somehow a diffusion in this landscape, which is biased due to different mechanisms. It could be biased because you are pulling with this trap, so there is, an external force, or it could be biased because of disorder effects and so on. But in the end, with this type of model, you can construct the model and describe a backtrack as a random walk in 1D between the speed sites. And then the key point is that they made an analogy between the recovery time of RNA polymerase and a first passage time of a bias random walk. So they say the time spent here is equivalent to the time that the random walker needs to exit this energy landscape. So there is an absorbing state and the elongation state, and the polymerase is doing something like this, jumps like this, so on. And then eventually it reaches the absorbing state. Of course, the pulse can be short, so you can come directly here, which is all these events. And the pulse can be also long, so the polymerase can stay somehow around here and then come. So these are these events. And this was a key insight, which was also discussed in this paper by Depkin, Galbraith, and Grill. It was a key insight because they introduced the notion of random walks in RNA polymerases. This is, let's say, the basis of the modeling. So this is part of the puzzle. So they say backtracking in pol 2, this is one species of polymerase. There are three species, pol 1, pol 2, and pol 3. In their experiments, they took pol 2 from yeast, and they saw that diffusion is the mechanism, according to their data, diffusion is the mechanism that allows recovery from backtracks. However, this is not all the puzzle. There were more experiments later by the Block Lab, which is also in California, as Bursamante Lab, and the Kornberg Lab. So Kornberg, you should know that he gained the Nobel Prize because of the discovery of the structure of polymerase. So these two labs work together with polymerase 2 as well, but with something called a transcription factor. This is a molecule that can bind to RNA polymerase 2 and help in cleaving the backtrack RNA. So this is like a scissor that comes here and can cut the RNA. So here I show the results for wild-type polymerase. You see when you put a force against the polymerase, you can get this type of pulses that are very, very long. So the polymerase never recovers when you exert a very strong force on it. However, when you put this molecule is very helpful for polymerase. You see, at very strong forces, it enters. So this is the run, the pause, a run, and a pause. It enters a pause, it stays a very, very long time, but it can recover. So this see, polymerase can recover almost from any deep backtrack when it binds to these TF2s. So this was very important. And also, they show the distribution of recovery times, which has sometimes like a power law, but the key of this work is that they somehow challenge a bit the random walk model because they find power laws with different exponents. So it's not always minus 3 halves, but sometimes they get something else. So they also claim that it is very hard with data because here you don't have much data. So you can get one of these per day or maybe one per week. So these are not many events. Maybe there are 100 events. So this is not like a simulation. Therefore, they claim it is very hard to fit this power loss and that the model may not be just diffusion. So this brings the second part of the puzzle, which is the cleavage. They claim RNA polymerase can cleave the RNA by different mechanisms. And in these two works, they studied POL2, the wild type, and POL2 with TF2S, which is what I just discussed. However, there's other polymerases like POL1, these are different species, which is the one we study. And we would like to know whether there is a common universal model to describe how all these three polymerases recover from a pathogen. So this is now our work. So we study these two polymerases. They look very similar, but they are different. So POL1 has this A12.2 C-terminus, which provides like an internal scissor. So it provides strong cleavage, can cleave very long RNAs, as was shown in molecular, in a bulk experiment, sorry. However, POL2 has a similar intrinsic cleavage mechanism that is weak, is the RPV9 subunit. But however, when you bind TF2S, it takes a structure that is homologous to POL1, and it has strong cleavage activity. However, this is a bit qualitative. It's strong, weak, strong, weak. We would like to give numbers to this. So for this, we design experiments. So this is all the things that we look for. POL1 and POL2, wild types. So this is what you get from the yeast directly. And then we have mutants. In the mutant, these were given by the Kramer lab in Göttingen. The mutant, they cut this A12.2 terminus, which is responsible of cleavage. So this enzyme won't be able to cleave and will be always, so so this enzyme can only recover by diffuse because it has this mechanism, but this one only diffuse. Here in Vol 2, we have also a mutant where we remove this RPV9 part. So we remove the scissor. So in principle, this enzyme can only recover by diffusion. So, and we have another variant, which is POL2 with TF2S. It is the wild type with TF2S, which helps to cleave the RNA. So in words, these two recover by cleavage and diffusion, these two by only diffusion, and this one by cleavage and diffusion, but cleavage is very strong. So I will show you experimental results for all these enzymes and a theory that describes all of them. So this was shown in our paper, published in 2016 in PNAS.
So how do you know the recovery mechanisms of each of these? Like they're known by some other technique or?
From previous experiments, it was known that these two can cleave and.
Experiments, not the optical presentation or.
Sorry. Well, in our case, so there is not enough resolution yet to see it because we only see like a random walk in 1D. And what we do is we have different models and we feed the models to the data. And there is, for example, the data for the position of the RNA polymerase as function of time. For these cases, it cannot be fitted to a diffusion model. This is our evidence. So we have an indirect way to measure which are the recovery mechanisms. We cannot see, there's no resolution yet to see the polymerase doing cutting or diffusing. Okay. It is not possible to do with microscopy right now, but in the future it could be possible. Okay. So by now there's no direct observation. But there are some bulk experiments. Bulk experiment means that you take a gel of polymerases and you let them flow and evolve in time, and they're a bit more qualitative because they don't look at a single polymerase. But there they also discuss that some things can only happen by cleavage. There is also the structural evidence. So they know the three-dimensional structure, and they can have also structures with the RNA and so on. So there are different studies, but by now it is impossible to see, like in a movie that I was showing before, the polymerase doing one thing or another. The microscope is not advanced enough.
So the cutting is done by dicer?
Sorry?
The cut, it's being done by the protein dicer? Or
Yes, this is a good question, but I am not an experimentalist, so I don't know. I'm not sure, totally sure. So you should check in the papers of Kramer, because they are experts on structure. But I would say so that I mean, this is a very complicated story. So it's probably, I mean, this is not done with a with a pipette and and by hand. So it's done really with very precise experimental steps. So probably it's with faith. Okay. More questions? Okay. So I will now discuss our paper and our experimental results. So this is the setup that we used. It's again a dual optical trap. This is where the experimentalist involved in the construction of the setup, where we trap two bits. One of the bits is covered by DNA, and the other is attached to a polymerase. And as I say, if you're lucky, you catch both, then you put both together and you pull them apart. And then this is in a NTP-rich medium, so you have to wait until the polymerase starts doing these runs. So you have to have a very lucky day to get this. So these experiments were done by Anna Lisica, which is a Croatian biologist now in UCL London. She did her PhD in these experiments, and I must say she did a great work and was working on this project for 7 years. So this is a very good data. So here you see our data for polymerase 2. Yeah, okay. So the red means disappose, and the black means is translocation or elongation. You wanted to know how do we discriminate red and black?
Yes.
Yeah, this is a good question, and basically we rely on data analysis techniques, and here what we did was we applied a low-pass filter, so we don't work to identify the pulses, we don't work with the noisy signal, but we work with this filter signal, which is this thin white line, and then we have a criterion on the slope of the filter trace. And when the slope is less than a threshold, then we say, okay, this is in a pulse. When it's larger than a threshold, then we say it is running.
Yes.
Some reds, but what we do is we have a numerical routine that is doing this. So we rely on the program, and I mean they seem steep, but if you zoom in, they are not so steep. So this is at kilohertz. I'm showing you 60. The scale here is seconds, but if you zoom in, this is kilohertz. So there are thousands of points inside here. So it may look it's steep, but I tell you it is not. But of course, you are here, you depend a lot on the noise, so it could be a fluctuation. It could be that here you are in a pulse, but it's a thermal fluctuation that is making this moving upwards. So sometimes you make mistakes. Actually, what is thought in all these experiments is that very short pulses are often not well identified. So usually we take this data, the data of the long pulses for our fits. But it's a very good observation. Yeah. More questions?
No.
Okay, I will go ahead then. So from this data, you can do these experiments with different enzymes. For instance, pol 1 and pol 2. This is our data. And you see, these are typical traces. You see that pol 1 is transcribing faster the same DNA template. Here, we can build different DNA templates, and here we put the same DNA template to the two different polymerases, and you see the slope is much higher in pol 1. It's transcribing 1.5 times faster. But then you can look at the pulse-free velocity. What is the velocity in the regions where there are no pulses? And you see that polymerase 1 is faster when you assist the polymerase with an external force, or when you are pulling against the polymerase. So in both cases, polymerase 1 is fast. Next, the first thing we look at was the pulses. How many pulses occur in the DNA template, and how long they are these pulses. So here we see that pole 1 pulses less often than pole 2 in all conditions, but the duration of the pulses is similar. So here you see there's a lot of noise. Each point is one experiment, so we have to do a lot of error analysis. So here we cannot conclude they are different from this data. However, we would like to see this in higher resolution and look at, for example, what is the time or the distribution of times of each of different patterns. Again, I'm showing you, as I said, from the question before, I was showing this in a very large scale, but now I show it in a more zoom scale. This is 1 second. There are thousands of points here. This is 20 nucleotides. So it's very, you see, these are the scales of the problem. So this is the experiment by Anna to measure the time to recover from a backtrack. Basically, it is illustrated here. So what we do is we the polymer starts running and enters a backtrack. And when it's in a backtrack, we reduce the force to zero. We do this by moving the trap to the location of the bead. You see that when the bead is out of the focus of the trap, there is a force pulling. So the optical trap is pulling the particle backwards with a force that is minus kappa x, where x is the distance between the bead and the trap. Whereas, so what we do here is there is a backtrack, and after some time in the backtrack, we move the trap here. So the force on the bead becomes zero. So here the force in the polymerase also is zero. So we look at the recovery of the polymerase in the absence of forces. So you see, here's another example. There is a run, and the polymer stalls, enters a backtracking state, and you see that from this distance to this distance, it has traveled backwards, let's say, I don't know, 20 nucleotides. So this is like you are in this situation. It has backtracked 20 nucleotides. And next what we do is we look at how long it takes to recover from this backtrack with zero force. This is what happens here. You backtrack, you reduce the force to zero, and then you look how long you take to recover. So this is the problem. We start, and in the experiment, we start with the polymer like this, and we look how long it takes for this to reach this state in which the active site is free. And we measure the time elapsed to reach this state. This we call recovery time, and this distance we call it backtrack depth. These two observables are what we use for our fits and for our calculations. So, these are the results. So here I show results for all the enzymes, for one, for two, and the mutants. The mutants, remember, they cannot cut the RNA, so they mostly recover by diffusion. And this data, it may seem a bit strange, but we do the following. So here I plot the recovery probability as a function of the backtrack depth. So these points are obtained by Anna by doing the following. She puts a clock for 5 minutes, and she waits whether the polymerase has backtracked or not. Sorry, it has recovered or not. If it has recovered, she puts a point here. If it has not recovered, she puts a point here. So it's 1 or 0. So this means that this point means there's a polymerase that was 70 nucleotides backtracked, and in 5 minutes, it didn't recover from the back. And this point means it was 20 nucleotides backtracked, and in 5 minutes, it recovered. So you can take this data and build a probability. So you can look and group this data and say, what is the probability that polymerases starting near 5 recover? This you can do very easily and build this type of curve that is a probability curve. So this is the probability that a polymerase starting in this depth recover from a backtrack. You see that from short backtracks, polymerases can recover, but from long backtracks is very unlikely. So all these curves decay with the depth. But they have different shapes. So here, this is falling at 20, this is falling around 10, and so on. And we would like to take this data, the red curve, and fit to some theory. And here is our theory, which is basically a random walk with some special modifications that I will discuss now. This is called a random walk with stochastic resetting. So what is this? So here we describe the polymerase as a Brownian particle that jumps between discrete states. So if the polymerase is here, so 3 means that the polymerase has backtracked 3 nucleotides, 1, 2, and 3. So if this ball moves to the right, means that the polymerase has backtracked another one. So instead of 3 here, there will be 4. So it would have moved to the right. And vice versa. It goes this way, it has moved in this way. So the active site is getting closer and closer to the recovery. And then this is the elongation state. So this is like an absorbing state in which when the polymerase reaches the elongation, then it resumes transcription. So it is important that this model looks a random walk because it has this diffusion rate k to the left and to the right everywhere. So you see that there is no bias in this dynamics because in our experiment we put it everything at zero force. So there is no bias, external bias. But then we say there is a probability to jump directly to here, either from here or from here or from here to here. This is the cleavage activity. So we call this, well, this is the cleavage rate. We say there is a probability that the polymerase goes from here to here instantaneously. So this would be that the polymerase comes with a scissor and cuts here. Instantaneously, the active site gets free. So you go from here to here. And well, this was introduced mainly by Martin Evans and Majumdar in 2011. There are a lot of papers now. Also, Shamik will discuss about this later. It is often called stochastic resetting. It's called resetting because the position is resetted to a given place. It's a bit strange because you would say, okay, this is like teleporting a particle to somewhere. But here is, you are not teleporting anything because this is not the position. This is the state of the polymerase. And you assume that this reaction is fast. So you say it can cut these vehicles. Then finally, let me tell you that we assume that there is this threshold. So from lambda, the polymerase cannot cut the RNA. So this means that if there are 55 nucleotides here, the polymerase doesn't have the energy to do this. And this, well, there are experimental observations by the group of Kornberg that they agree with this type of threshold. So this is our model. And we would like to use this model to fit all the polymerases. So this is what I will try to show. So, well, as I said, this was the cartoon. You are in backtracking and you can recover by diffusion or by cleavage. And in the model, you will have simulations that will look like this. So this is the backtrack depth. You want to reach this absorbing barrier. And you can reach it during diffusion like this. Or you can reach it also by entering the region where you can cleave and cleaving. So this would be stochastic resetting, and this would be diffusion. By the way, if you want to read about this, we have this paper where we explain all the calculations and everything very precisely. So I will show you a movie of such a simulation. So I will put some polymerases starting here. They don't interact each other, so they are each of them is an independent run. Here there is a clock that is in seconds, and they start from 15, and there is this cutoff. So they can cleave if they are in this region, but if they are in this region, they cannot cleave. And this is the absorbing elongation state. So there it goes. They start here, and they start diffusing. And you see one recovered by cleavage. These ones are getting out of the region of cleavage. So this one also recovered by cleavage, and this one as well. And you see that long pauses can happen because polymerases cannot recover, because they got very lost with very long backtracks. So this one also recovered, and this one didn't. This is more or less the time scale. This is minutes and seconds. So you can measure here the times that took to the polymerases to recover from the back. This is what we call the recovery time. This is an important observable. And the average of these times would be the mean recovery time, which is something we can measure easily in the experiment. Secondly, another important measure will be the recovery probability, which is what I was showing you in the experimental data. So this we would estimate by counting the number of polymerases that recover, here 4, divided by the total number of polymerases, here 5. So here we would have 80% of recovery probability. Of course, this is a simulation. This is done with a Gillespie algorithm. It's quite easy to do. But we would like to fit. So how do we do the fitting? I didn't know how to solve this analytically, so I followed a brute force technique. I can tell you a funny thing. I'm from the Basque country in Spain. in the Basque Country, we have a very famous sport that is, it consists on taking a big stone and lifting it up with your hands. Here you have 300 kilos. This man is getting, I mean, it's very tough. So what we do is a brute force technique in which we have a parameter space, which is this cube. This is the diffusion rate, the cleavage rate, and the backtrack depth. These are reasonable numbers. And in each of these, so we have here almost 500,000 of points. And for each of these points, we run 1,000 simulations. And from these 1,000 simulations, we build a curve like this one. And we see how well this curve fits the experimental data. So this is a bit crazy. So we do the fit. We repeat this all along this cube. And we look at the values of the parameters that get the best fit, so the highest R squared. So you see that for pole 1 and pole 2, we get different clouds. These are the clouds where the parameter values are good, so where you are getting good fits. So you see, for example, that lambda is higher for pole 2 than pole 1 and pole 2, and it's double. So you see differences already in this cloud. But we would like to get the best point here. And this is the way we do. So we find the best fit in these curves, and this is our values of K, K, C, and lambda. I hope it was clear, but if you have doubts, let me ask. Just ask me. Okay, so this was the experimental data, and with this brute force technique, we fit the red curves here, and we get the following. So you see the fits are very good. So, for example, in pole 1 and pole 2, fit is excellent, and interestingly, you cannot use a diffusion model to fit this, because the diffusion model has the property that the backtrack recovery probability, it cannot do this plateau and then go down. It decays with negative slope like this, and this curvature. You cannot get this curvature with a diffusion model. So this is the way we discriminate the diffusion model here. But you see the fits are very good, and here down we compare the mutant, which is the black curve, with the wild type, which is here the dash curve. You see mainly that the wild type is performing better in recovery than the mutant for short backtracks, but for long backtracks, the mutant is better. It is better because it diffuses faster. This is more or less the story, so I'll show it later. Here in pole 2, it's a bit different, so the wild type performs much better than the mutant. Okay, so out of these fits, we can get useful information because, well, as I said, we fit the wild types to this model, and we fit the mutants to the same model, but with KC0 and lambda, there's no lambda because there is no KC. So it's this random walk, basically. Out of this, we get these parameters, and they are very interesting because this, for example, these parameters were not known. No one did the pole 1 until our work. So you see that pole 2 diffuses faster, twice faster than pole 1. But pole 1 has a much stronger cleavage activity. So it cleaves twice faster than pole 2. And it cleaves also twice longer RNAs than pole 2. So it's much more efficient in cleavage. You see the R squared is very good. Then you see the mutants are different. So pole 1 is diffusing very fast. So when you cut out this part in this structure, you get double, well, more than double, it's like five times the diffusion. And pole 2 is similar diffusion as the mutant. Despite that they have similar diffusion, you see it performs much worse. Okay, so this is more or less the main result. The backtrack recovery mechanism is determined by a kinetic competition between diffusion and cleavage. Here I show this curve, maybe a bit confusing, but I'm just showing the wild types. This is pole 1, the black, the recovery probability, and this is pole 2, the total recovery probability. What I show in red and blue is the fraction of recoveries by cleavage or diffusion. You see, for example, in pole 1, actually it's this black curve, most of the long backtracks starting from here are recovered by cleavage. In pole 2 is different. Well, what you see is that in pole 2 is the black curve. For long backtracks, it's half and half. So these two are more or less balanced. So half of the times, pole 2 recovers by diffusion, and half of the times by cleavage. And this we will see in these movies. So I will show movies now with realistic parameters, this is pole 1 and this is pole 2. We have different cutoffs. Sorry, this should be 20 here. Pole 1 has the cutoff of the cleavage of our resetting here, and pole 2 has the cutoff 10. Okay. And they will start both from 10 here, which corresponds to this vertical line. So you see for pole, actually this is a bit strange. For pole 1, we predict that most of them will recover by cleavage or by resetting. And for pole 2, will be more by cleavage than the first. So there it goes. You see, pole 1, this was a recovery by cleavage, another by cleavage. This one is getting lost. But look, it recovered by cleavage. This one as well, all of them recover. 100% recovery probability, all by cleavage. I will play this backwards for pole 2 because I didn't have time to tell you. So you see that these curves have bigger spread because they have higher diffusion rate. And this recovered by diffusion. It's difficult to see, but it did. And this by diffusion. And these are being getting lost. But I guess one of them will recover, let's say, like cleavage, but we will see. As I say, this is stochastic, so you can see that it is. Okay, so here you have 20, well, 2 out of 5, so 40% recovery probability, which is like, here we have 60, so more or less, and here is 100%. This is when you are starting in 10. But what happens when you start in a deep backtrack, you start from 25. So you will see that first pole 1, but you see that these guys are diffusing much more. You see, this is the uncertainty is increasing much faster than in pole 1. You see, one recovery by cleavage. There was this big jump. This one is getting close, cleavage. So two recoveries, which means 40%, they are here, and all of them by cleavage. So the red curve is here. Whereas in pole 2, in these five simulations. These are not experiments, eh? These are simulations, remember. In these simulations, we get 0% of recovery. But the theory predicts 20%. So one needs to do much more simulations to see the numbers. Because these curves are obtained by simulations, they are not obtained from analytical calculations.
The tail of the distribution is a power law?
Sorry?
The tail of this recovery probability distribution is a power law?
No, actually not. But I can. It cannot be, because it has to go to...
Wait. Yeah, is it expensive?
I don't know. No. I don't know, because we couldn't solve this model analytically. So, I don't know. That is a good question.
Probably power law. That's why it's more likely. Yeah. Because the curve looks like a power law, except the bottom one. Except the bottom one.
I could have plotted this in log-log scale, but I didn't do.
Yeah.
Could be. I don't know. It's a good question. But as I said, this model was very challenging for us analytically. So that's why I started to work with Shamik. And you will see another story later. But here is just simulation. Actually, we could solve a simpler model for POL2 TF2S. So I talked about these enzymes, but I didn't talk about the last one, which is the wild type POL with TF2S, which is something that can bind here and help in a cleavage. For this, these are the experiments by Anna. You see that when you don't have TF2S, you can enter this big pause, but when you have TF2S in the medium, you can recover from very deep backtracks. And you see here there are a lot of pauses and recoveries, so it's really, really efficient. It rescues the backtrack pole 2. Here is a comparison between the results for the wild type and the results for the enzyme TF2S. You see that it can recover from 50, 100, 150 very, very, very deep backtracks using this POL2 transcription factor. Not also it can recover, but also it recovers very fast. So this is the mean recovery time for POL1, POL2, and POL2 TF2S. It is significantly much faster than the other. So it's really, really efficient. It's the best of all of them. So here we came up with a simplified version of the model. So we say, okay, this enzyme can recover from almost everywhere. So we just put lambda to infinity and we have this model. And this one we can solve and get everything exact as we showed in this PRE paper. So in the model, this is just the stochastic resetting of a particle starting from a state, and it can diffuse and cleave or come to state zero from any position with rate kc. Here are some simulations. Here, for example, you start from 5 and you recover by diffusion. Then you start from 5 and you recover by cleavage with this jump. When you cut out the cleavage, you can only recover by diffusion. And maybe this is related to PK's question, which is what is the distribution of times to recover. So you pick these times, you build a histogram. So when you have diffusion and cleavage, the distribution, it has like a power law at intermediate times, but then it's cut off at long times. Because there's nothing that can survive a very long time. You stay here, and at the very end, with a time that is 1 over kc, you come back, you come down. That's why you have this cutoff. When you only have diffusion, in the standard random walk, you have this power law at all times. It's something interesting for students, because you can solve this very easily. So you start here, and how long it takes to reach the absorbing state. So you can measure these times, but the interesting thing is that it is a power law, so the average of this distribution is infinity. So the average time starting from this state to reach the absorbing state is infinite. This is quite remarkable, but you can understand in the sense that this is pure diffusion, so there are trajectories that come here that never return, because there is no bias. But interestingly, if you put a very, very little bias to the left, the mean recovery time becomes finite. So it is a very, very strange thing that just putting an epsilon bias, the mean recovery time is not infinity. But in this case, it's infinity because there's no cleavage. Okay. When there is no cleavage. Okay, so this is the model, the reality. And we tried to solve this model. As I said, you can check our paper for everything in detail, but you can describe the dynamics of this model with a master equation, which is this equation that I show here, that I will try to explain in as simple as I can. So PNT is the probability that you are in state N at time T with the initial condition that you were at N0. So for example, I say, I put initial condition 2. What is the probability that at time T 3 seconds, I'm in state 4? This is this PNT. As I say, I put an absorbing boundary at N equals 0. And this is the equation that rules the dynamics of P and T. So what is the logic? Well, this is mainly for students, but the change in the probability in this state, so the probability can increase by from these events. So you can jump from 2 to 3, or from 4 to 3. These are these fluxes, positive fluxes, with rate k. It can decrease because you can get out by diffusion to 2 and 4, but it can also decrease because you can get out by cleavage. That's why you get a negative term here. So arrows that get out from the state are these ones, and arrows that go in are these ones. Of course, this state is special because you cannot come from 0, so that's why it doesn't have a plus k pn minus 1 here. So this is the model. It's simple, and you can solve it analytically. Well, it's maybe a classic in random walk. But we were interested in knowing what is the total recovery probability. What is the probability that an enzyme starting in n equal 5, for example, has recovered at time tau rec? So in order to account for this, you need to add two fluxes of recovery. So you can recover by diffusion, which would be jumping all around without cleaving and entering through the state 1. Is this term. And secondly, you can recover by cleavage. So you are in any state and you cleave, which is the second term. You see that this is the probability times a rate. So this has units of 1 over time, as it should be for a distribution of times. And this is, you go in this way with this rate k, and you should be in state 1 at time tau rec. And this one is, you can be anywhere and come by cleavage. So this is called mainly the survival probability. Survive because we say, okay, when you come here, you die, you cannot get out. So by measuring P1 and the survival probability, you can calculate this analytically. And this we did. Formula looks a bit long, but it's not that bad. here this is an exponential decay, which is this cutoff that I was saying. Then you have a Bessel function of order n0, this is time tau, divided by t. This is the first term that comes from the probability to be in state 1. And the second term is a bit more complicated. It has this exponential cutoff as well, and it has here, well, first a power for tau rec to the power n0, and then h, which is a function, it's a hypergeometric function. So, well, this is a complicated story, but you can put this in mathematical and make curves, and well, it's well-behaved function. So there's no problem. Out of this, you can get the average recovery time, and you get this nice formula. So this is quite tough, but this formula looks more friendly. So it depends on n0, on the initial distance, like a power. But it's a negative power. This is, you can write it as 1 minus e to the minus n0 something. So the farther you go, no, sorry, it's the opposite. So the closer you go, the less recovery time. It's a, well, you can check in the paper because I don't remember perfectly right now. Okay, so so this is the model that we can solve, the discrete random walk model. But one can also take the approximation of the case where you do many jumps in all directions and cleavage is very, it's very small. In this case, one may be tempted to take this continuous diffusion model in which you have a particle diffusing like a Wiener process and it can recover by cleavage from any side of a continuous line. In this way, you will transform the master equation shown here on the left into a diffusion equation with this rate of cleavage, or it's like absorbing from any position. So this is more or less taking the continuous limit of this equation. So here are curves of this model. You have recovery by cleavage, you are diffusing. You see that you have infinite states. Here you do discrete jumps, but here you have infinite states, and you can recover by cleavage or by diffusion. So they look similar, and we try to analyze similarities and differences between these two models. Interestingly, the diffusion model has the advantage that all the expressions are much simpler than in the discrete model. This is the recovery probability. Again, it appears, this is from the diffusion flux, but this is just like an inverse Gaussian, e to the minus 1 over tau, the power law. This is the power law t minus 3 halves. Plus the second term that has the exponential cutoff and an error function. This is, error function is the integral of the Gaussian in a finite region, more or less. Okay, so you can take this and measure the average recovery time, and it has this very nice expression. You see, now it appears, what I was saying, this negative exponential, so I was right. It has this 1 minus e minus x. So now what you can do is try to make an equivalence between the two models, and here we did, I showed the mean recovery time as a function of the initial distance. So you see that the mean recovery time increases the farther you go, the longer you take to recover. And I'm scaling the recovery time by the cleavage time. This is the average time to make a cut. And I'm scaling the position by a critical factor depth, which is this number. So what you see is that this is the continuous model, this curve, and this is the discrete model, which always recovers faster than the continuous model, but it tends to the same value as the continuous model when nc becomes large, so when k is much larger than k. So this means that there are equivalent statistics when diffusion dominates over cleavage, when you have to do a lot of jumps to recover, basically. In this case, the details of the template do not matter very much, and the two mechanisms are equivalent. So you can use the diffusion model for this problem in this limit, the limit of k much greater than k. Okay, so this, we assume that limit, and we took experimental data in this, for this enzyme, the pol 2 TF2S, which recovers from any backtrack, and for this case, we have very, very precise measurement of the mean recovery time, which is this curve here, up to 30 nucleotides. So here, the green is the experiment, the black is the theory, which is this exponential, and we see a very good fit between the theory and experiment. But the fit, I was showing you the fit only up to 40, but we can fit very, very deep backtracks up to 160. So you got this exponential behavior, and from the fit you can get the main parameters of O2TF2S. So basically we see diffuses very fast, much faster than the wild type. It cleaves very fast, 5 times more often. Well, this is how many times it happens. So 5 times more often O2 cleaves than the wild type, and it cleaves every 10 seconds, so it's really fast. So we could say it's the most efficient enzyme of all the ones that we tested. With this, I reached the conclusion. So the first conclusion is POL1 is faster than POL2 and poses less often. This is what we observe in the runs. We have quantified diffusion cleavage rates of POL1 and POL2, introducing a model that describes a large amount of polymerases. It's important to say that intrinsic cleavage is very important in POL1. And in both cases, they fall beyond a critical buffer depth, but POL1 can cleave much faster and much longer RNA. This is what I say here. And the POL2 with TF2 is the most efficient enzyme that we have tested. So I would like to thank my collaborators, which are many, Sariana, who did all these nice experiments, in the group of Stefan, with whom I discussed a lot, Daniel Sanzatabul, which helped a lot in the theory, in this PRI paper, and is a great friend of mine, and also Christoph Engel, Markus Janel, Eric Galbut, and Patrick Kramer. I hope I don't forget anyone. Also, Shamin Gupta, which we'll talk about something else later. Before finishing, this is an announcement of the International PhD Opportunity. This is a PhD position that we are opening, me and Shamik. This position will be between Ramakrishna Mission, Vivekananda University, and ICTP. So we expect someone to do the PhD locally in Kolkata, but with opportunities to come to ICTP as a visitor. And as you see, we are very broad scientists, so we are proposing a project that comes for diffusions, for active matter, even could be astrophysics. You can talk with Amika about this. Application must reach before 31st of May, of March. So there's not much time, but we really expect, if you are interested, that you contact us for this epic PhD opportunity. This is how Trieste looks like. I made myself this picture. This is the Bay of Trieste from the top. And I think that's it. So thank you very much for your attention, and look forward for the discussions. Thank you. Well, any question is welcome, even students. Even if you think it's a stupid question, please make the question, because stupid questions are the best. So
testable predicts of some
don't be shy.
Are there testable predicts of some from your model?
Testable predictions
from your model. Are there predictions?
We have already tested these predictions, huh? And with the experimental data.
There are other predictions. It's a good question by TK, because I saw only some data, but you can take other data that I didn't show. That is the recovery time. So here I have the mean recovery time as a function of the bacterial depth. So this is a data that is less precise as the recovery probability from the way we measure, and also because distributions of times are much more prone to fluctuations. So here, this is the average recovery time in the experiment, and line is the prediction from the model for the recovery time. So it works very well for POL2 TF2S, but for the other two, it's much harder. I must say, this is very difficult to fit, because this is not an average totally, it's just some points that we get. So basically, we get here an average out of 3 points. So it's a good prediction, more or less, but the data is very noisy for this.
Oh, yeah.
So we could predict other things, as I say, but much harder to fit due to the little amount of statistics.
More questions? So we thank you very much for, you know, agreeing to give this talk, and I think it went off very well, no? I think we all will agree. So let's clap for Zoom and also for Edgar. So we have a tea break now, and then when we come back, it's my talk, but you wanted to question me during the talk, right? So we'll connect again maybe later.
Okay, okay. Which time is your talk exactly?
So we are running slightly behind schedule, so we come back in 15 minutes, let's say.
Okay, okay. I'll be here.
You can have a coffee or something, and then 5-star coffee while we come back after having 2-star.
Okay, okay. I'll do the same. Get a coffee, turn coffee, come back. I cut the connection and we talk now. Okay.
Yeah, yeah. Okay.
Okay, see you.